I recognize the honourable member from Dartmouth South.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. What an honour and a privilege it is to stand before you and the rest of this House this morning to offer a few comments in response to our government's speech from the throne as delivered by His Honour the Lieutenant Governor. Before going any further, Mr. Speaker, let me take this opportunity to congratulate all of the members of this House on their election to the Legislature on October 8th. Many on both sides of these chambers are very experienced individuals, returning with many years of experience. For many others, however, myself and yourself, Mr. Speaker, included, this is our first time sitting in these honoured chambers. It is my sincere hope and my expectation that going forward, we will all work together, combining our experience, our exuberance, our traditions, our innovations, our political positions, and our aspirations for the benefit of our province and all of our constituents. I'd also like to take a moment to recognize my fellow candidates in this recent election. Ms. Mary Vingo, who ran for the NDP, Mr. Gord Gamble, who ran for the Progressive Conservatives, and Mr. Jim Murray, who ran as an independent. Ours was an extremely clean and cordial campaign on all fronts, and I thank them all for their professionalism and for putting their names forward in the first place. If I may beg this House's indulgence for just a few moments, Mr. Speaker, I'd be remiss if I didn't take a little bit of time to thank some of the people who were so instrumental in helping me with my election campaign. From being nominated as a candidate back in February, all the way to my successful election as the MLA in Dartmouth South. Beginning first and foremost with my campaign manager, Mr. Vishal Bardwaj. A proud East Indian immigrant to Canada, Vishal represents everything that our province and our nation stands for. A home to those who were born here, as well as those who come here from other countries, who simply want to educate and improve themselves, who want to work, who want to live and raise their families in comfort and in safety. It is a true testament of those ideals, Mr. Speaker, that Vishal, his wife Shelley, their children Reva and Razik, and his mother and in-laws all take such an active role in the politics of our province and country, including helping so much with my campaign. Mr. Speaker, I am also particularly grateful to Kathy Conrad, a personal friend of my wife and I, who from early in March, right up until the eve of Election Day, canvassed virtually every street in our wonderful riding of Dartmouth South with me. Kathy and I knocked on some 8,000 doors. We met many thousands of constituents, some of them two and three times over. Kathy and I can tell you that we can now instantly direct you to the steepest streets, the longest driveways, the highest hills, and the highest front doors virtually anywhere in our riding. And there are a lot of them. We made friends with countless dogs and cats as well. We were invited in, and on rare occasions, invited, not so politely, to leave. But ultimately, I could never have achieved my goal of meeting as many of our constituents as possible without Kathy's help, and I thank her. I must also thank my official agent, Doug Livingston, whose advice, guidance, and stern hand kept our campaign on the impeccable path which I and the rest of my team are so proud of. Mr. Speaker, there are so many other people whose roles I haven't really got time to go into detail at this point who played a part, but I need to, at the very least, mention and publicly thank them for their efforts, including Barb and Bernie Hart, Terry and Charlie Berube, Terry Beard, Peggy Landis, Ian McLeod, Brian Churchill, Tracy Prieper, Mark Hubley, Linda Tweedy, Coralie Merrin-Beauchamp, and Jane Cordy. Again, Mr. Speaker, there are dozens more, but I won't take any more of this House's time at this opportunity to mention them by name, but I still want to thank them for their efforts and their assistance. I think it's important to point out, Mr. Speaker, that other than Kathy Conrad, all of the aforementioned people that I've just mentioned are people that I only met after declaring my intention to seek nomination. For over 30 years, I was a radio and television journalist. Throughout my career, like most of my former colleagues, I might add, I took great pains to try and avoid displaying any political preferences. I've always believed that impartiality and objectivity are the hallmarks of journalistic integrity. As a result, political associations and relationships were virtually non-existent for me prior to indicating that I'm going to run for office. as well. It was an old friend of mine who actually sits in our cabinet now as a government member who convinced me to run for this position in the first place. I say all of this, Mr. Speaker, merely to point out how appreciative I am that all of the people who put so much faith in me and confidence in me without really knowing me. As I've told all of them before, I only hope that I can truly live up to all of their expectations. As others have already pointed out so well in this House, Mr. Speaker, when a person decides to run for public office, members of their family become as involved in the proceedings as the candidates themselves. In fact, it might be said that family members often make even greater sacrifices, Mr. Speaker. And with that in mind, I must say a very special thank you to my wife, Yvonne. My true soulmate, Yvonne, has been with me through so many trials, tribulations, and celebrations over the past 36 years or so. Together, we have seen good times, we've seen bad times. We have weathered financial ups and downs. There have been trying times at work. There have been celebrations of marriages and births. We have buried all of our parents. We have buried two of Yvonne's siblings. Yvonne has survived breast cancer, diabetes, and vascular disease. And I have beaten prostate cancer, having my prostate removed just a year ago. Since the day we first met, thank you. Since the very first day we met, I have been in love with Yvonne, and I can honestly say I do not know what I would do without her. Mr. Speaker, Yvonne and I have a truly amazing daughter, Deborah, who now lives in Kanata, Ontario, with her husband, Nick, and their two children, our 9-year-old grandson, Michael, and our 3-year-old granddaughter, Hope. I was so fortunate to have our daughter and grandson actually come to Dartmouth to spend the final days of the campaign and election night with us. I am truly blessed to have such a wonderful and supportive wife and family. I mentioned how we have buried all of our parents. I can't help but take a moment to pause and reflect on how proud I hope my mom and dad, Gus and Grace Rowe, would be of me today. I was adopted by them when I was 2.5 years old. Dad, a Newfoundlander, was serving overseas with the Newfoundland Regiment during World War II when he met my mom in Glasgow. In fact, they were actually married in Glasgow during the Blitz. After the war, they moved to Newfoundland and later to Hamilton, Ontario, where they adopted me, and shortly after, an infant girl as well. My sister now lives in New Brunswick with her family. Although Dad passed away over 16 years ago, and my mom nearly 8 years ago, I can still see them smiling lovingly from the gallery. I was also fortunate enough to meet my mother, my birth mother, Louise Harding, a few years ago, before she too passed away. I never met my birth father, Henry Barclay, who was apparently born in Stellarton and worked in the coal mines, before marrying Louise, who was from New Brunswick, and the two of them moving to Hamilton, Ontario, as it turned out, where I and 3 other siblings were born. It is my sincere hope that they both now realize that their decision to put me, the youngest child, up for adoption was one that was indeed the right one. I owe all of my parents so very, very much. Mr. Speaker, I began my remarks by mentioning my campaign manager, Vishal Bhardwaj. And as I look around at my honoured colleagues throughout this House on both sides, I can't help but marvel at the diversity that is represented here. We range in age from our 20s to our, okay, well, let's just say considerably older. We represent a wide variety of ethnic, cultural, and religious groups and sexual orientations. There are parents. There are single parents. There are grandparents. Some of us are married, Mr. Speaker. Some of us are single. We have come from all walks of life. There are educators, there are legal practitioners, there are health practitioners, laborers, business persons, and retailers. We have lobbyists, student leaders, scientists, economists, and yes, dare I say it, even journalists. But for all of our difference, Mr. Speaker, what we all share is the fact that the majority of our constituents in each of our respective ridings believes that we're the best people to speak for them and represent them in this legislature. They have entrusted us with the responsibilities of enacting laws, controlling the purse strings, watchdogging government, and providing a public forum for all Nova Scotians. Let there be no mistake, Mr. Speaker, these responsibilities are neither easy nor frivolous. As to the former, I'll make a few comments on our government's plans to shoulder responsibilities as outlined in our speech from the throne in just a few moments. But first, I want to speak to the latter, the importance and the onerous of these responsibilities, the onerousness, rather. Just a few weeks ago, Mr. Speaker, like many of my colleagues in this House, I had the honour of laying a wreath at Sullivan's Pond at the Cenotaph in Dartmouth as part of the annual Remembrance Day ceremonies. That was a time to remember and honour all of those who have served in our Canadian forces and paid the ultimate sacrifice in the defence of freedom and democracy, the reason that we are all sitting here in these chambers this afternoon. We have more than just a job to do in these chambers, Mr. Speaker. We have the responsibility of ensuring that those who gave their lives didn't do so in vain. By working together to better the lives of all Nova Scotians, regardless of race, colour, creed, or political affiliation. As to our plans as a government, Mr. Speaker, the throne speech delivered by His Honour, the Lieutenant Governor, provides a very clear insight into our intention to move our province forward. Already I've heard it suggested by some members opposite that, quote, there's nothing really new in this speech from that there's something that previous governments have said much the same thing when they outlined their intentions but subsequently failed to deliver. I tell you this, Mr. Speaker, every single member on this side of the House is committed to doing all that they can to deliver everything put forward in our speech from the throne. Mr. Speaker, we intend to improve the lives of Nova Scotians by ensuring true consumer choice and fairness in the provision of electricity, by enhancing support for employee training and skills development, by assisting our entrepreneurs, young and old, by reinvesting in our school system, by realigning our healthcare to put patients and families first, and by investing in our communities to better the lives of our seniors, people with disabilities, and for those in need as well. Mr. Speaker, these are indeed ambitious plans and goals which my government has outlined, but they are plans and goals which can and will be achieved. My riding of Dartmouth South represents an ideal sampling of everything our province has to offer. We have young and small entrepreneurs establishing bakeries, restaurants, galleries, and specialty retail outlets in our downtown. We have artists, performers, musicians, playwrights, and authors all presenting their works at venues throughout our riding in places like schools, church halls, and of course, Alderney Landing. We have museums and art galleries. We have dozens of historical buildings and sites highlighted by things like Evergreen House, Old City Hall, the Star Skate Factory, and our wonderful Shubenacadie Canal system. We have schools, we have parks and ball fields and community centers, and we have youth programs. We also have senior centers and seniors complexes. We have the Dartmouth General Hospital, where it has the potential to create a provincial, if not national, leader in the field of specialized surgeries. The riding, Mr. Speaker, of Dartmouth South is a vibrant and growing riding. It is no different from the ridings of each and every one of my colleagues on both sides of this House. But, Mr. Speaker, for those communities like mine to continue to grow and to develop, to attract new businesses and families, to improve their individual economies, and thereby the economy of our province and our region as a whole, that requires an understanding and responsible government. It requires a government that will listen before deciding what action has to be taken and what needs to be done, and then after listening, taking that action and moving on what needs to be done. It requires a government that is led by vision, guided by principle, and acts on compassion. I believe, Mr. Speaker, the speech from the throne makes it clear Nova Scotia has elected such a government. And in closing this morning, Mr. Speaker, I am proud to say I am part of that government. I am proud of our leader. I am proud of the team that he has assembled, and I am proud to be the voice of Dartmouth South in this legislature. I look forward to working and cooperating with my colleagues on both sides of these respected chambers to better the lives of my constituents and all Nova Scotians. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.